We want to welcome you to another edition of God's Living Word, a program brought to you by First Presbyterian Church of Greenville, Ohio. First Presbyterian is located in historic downtown Greenville at 114 East 4th Street. We can be reached by phone at 937-548-3188. We hope as a result of this service that you will find that our message is uplifting and meaningful to help you in your daily walk in spiritual life as a Christian. Throughout the week, we have several ministries that I know will be of help to you. Wednesdays in particular, there are several Bible studies for both adults as well as children. Our Logos ministry is for children preschool through fifth grade. We have JAM, Jesus and Me, for junior highs, and then our senior high ministry Wednesday evening. If you do not have a church home, we invite you to participate and be involved in our worshiping community, whether on the airwaves or certainly personally in the congregation. At this time, we'd like to invite you to be part of our family of faith here at First Presbyterian as we worship the Lord and listen to God's living word. Let's worship God in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we come together in our time of thanksgiving and praise, a great thanksgiving hymn, "Come Ye Thankful People Come," and then the praise song, "Give Thanks." Let's join together in worshiping our Lord.
Say, I am what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks.
Let us pray. Our loving God, we thank you for the opportunity to come together as a community of faith and worship you. We thank you for your gracious kindness that reaches out to us and draws us to your side. We thank you for the love that Jesus showed us when he went to the cross to die for our sins, and for the Holy Spirit of God who empowers, enlivens, sustains, and comforts us. Now, in the silence of these moments, we lift up our personal confession to you, knowing that you hear us and will forgive us. Hear the good news of the gospel. If we confess our sin, God is faithful and just to forgive our sin and cleanse us from all wrong. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Morning. How many of you know what's happening this week that makes it kind of exciting for everybody? What's happening this week? That's right, it's Thanksgiving. And families usually get together and are just so thankful that they can all be together and all that they have and just to enjoy. And they have turkey. Mm-hmm. Lots of people have turkey and sometimes too much turkey and pumpkin pie, right? But today I want to talk about how we need to be thankful when we're praying each day, because sometimes I just make a want list for God. Please, God, I want this to happen, and please, God, could this happen? And sometimes I need to remember to be more thankful when I'm praying. So some of the things that we are thankful for, easy things to be thankful for, like when we get toys, when it's a birthday or Christmas or something, those are kind of biggies that we're like, oh, even a flashlight, we say, wow, thank you, God, for all the good toys I keep getting. But sometimes we need to remember to say, you know, there's other stuff I could be thankful for that's just little things. So I made a thankful box right here. And I just decided to put just some random stuff in here that, like, I'll try to think of how could I be thankful for this stuff. Well, I picked up this bottle and I thought, well, I'm thankful that somebody made bottles of water so when I'm out walking and get thirsty, I can get a drink. And I'm thankful it looks like somebody got a nice drink and got hydrated here. Or I could be thankful that nobody littered this and made trash on our earth, or I could be thankful that I could recycle this. Oh my goodness, look. What is that? What is that? That's a shoelace. How could I be thankful for a shoelace? How could that be something to be thanking God for? Sure, it's much easier to keep our shoes on if we've got shoelaces, isn't it? So I could be thankful, and I could be thankful for teachers and families that love me and teach me how to tie my shoelaces. Or I could be thankful even when I trip on my shoelaces that somebody helps me up and is kind to me. Oh my goodness, how could I be thankful for tape? What good is tape? Do you ever get a birthday gift and it's wrapped up in a package and you have to untape it? What else can you use tape for? Can you think of something? Yeah, putting things together, or like if a page gets torn, I always have a first grader coming up needing some of this because they're worried about their page got torn. I've got lots of things in here. Sunscreen, I could think about being thankful. Paper, because I'm always needing to write notes. Why could I be thankful for a Band-Aid? Why should I be thankful? I guess I'm thankful somebody invented Band-Aids. Yes. Sure, if you get scratched, it's a good thing to have, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah, when you've got a hurt. Yeah. Oh, it keeps the blood there. I'm thankful it keeps the blood there so it doesn't run out. Yeah. So, anyway, I'm going to tell you there's still other things, but I think if you went home, you could find all kinds of little things, too, that you could say, you know, I'm not just thankful for these big fancy things I get for my birthdays and things, but I can just be thankful for everyday little things. And I want to show you this box I'm thankful for. This is a shoe box, isn't it? I'm going to tell you we're all thankful when we get new shoes and they come in a shoe box, but there's something I want to tell you about that's special this week. It started November 14th and it ends on the 21st. There's a group called Samaritan's Purse. And what they do is they have Operation Shoebox. And you can fill a shoebox with special treasures for children all around the world who might not be getting any treats at the holidays. And there's a shoebox drop-off right here in Greenville, and it's even open this afternoon and tomorrow at Faith Baptist Church. So you can look online and it'll show you what kind of things and what age you can choose to get things for a little boy or a little girl. And you can make a thankful shoebox for them of treasures. I want to read a Bible verse to you from 1 Thessalonians 5:18 that says, this is what Jesus wants us to do. Give thanks in all circumstances. Even when we need a Band-Aid, we're supposed to give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Let's bow our heads and fold our hands. Dear God, help me to have a thankful heart for big things and for little things. Amen. Thank you guys for coming down.
Last Sunday, Wes and I were in Michigan and got up at 5 a.m., because you know we're always late for everything, and drove back here so that we could be here for the service last week. And it was wonderful with all the little children and all the things that went on. And I'm glad I got up again today and came, because all those children sitting there. Thank you, Luann. You're not quite back up there yet, but thank you for doing that. Today, as I look around and I see each one of you, my heart is very touched, just as something I'm so thankful for is this church family. And I probably can't say much more. But anyway, I just want to do a special welcome. I see the Cornells are here, and their little Eve was walking back and forth, wasn't she? Have you told everybody? I know Ed and Kathy have. Another one on the way. Yeah. And I want to say hello to Josh and Brandy are here. Have you told everybody? Your mother told everybody. Okay, I love that. Anyway, it is wonderful to have you all visiting. And we hope that anybody else who might be visiting for a first time or two will sense a warm welcome and come back again and again. And it's good to have you home from college, too. No babies yet. Okay, there are welcome packets in the back for anyone wanting to know more about our church. If you see a new face, offer to find one of those packets for them. Be sure to sign and pass the friendship register back and forth. If there's somebody that you haven't seen for a while or a face that's not quite familiar, be sure to follow up and say hello to them. And after church, please join others in the fellowship hall for coffee and goodies following the service. The activities for Wednesday will be canceled this week, of course, because of Thanksgiving. Pastor John's 10:30 a.m. Bible study will be canceled, and Logos and Jam and the senior highs will be canceled. It seems too soon to talk about Christmas, but there are several announcements that have to do with that. The worship and music committee is selling poinsettias again this year, and they will be placed in the sanctuary for the Christmas season and can be taken home on Christmas Eve. The annual Christmas caroling party will be on Sunday, December 11th. Carolers will meet at the church at 6 o'clock p.m. and divide into groups to sing. I had five written down. Thanks, John. 5 o'clock. Thank you. I kind of go on my time. There are a lot of you that have lived with us for a long time. At 5 o'clock. Yeah. And we'll divide into groups to sing carols to our homebound members. Afterwards, join the family at Dick and Diane Brown's house for our traditional fellowship time. And there are RSVP forms in the bulletins. Quarters for Christmas. The deacons are collecting quarters and any other change for the residents of the Dark County home to be used in the vending machines this Christmas season. Donations will be accepted for that through November 27th. Carrie Driscoll, who usually sits kind of right where Helen is, right in there, but they're not here today, but they're regular visitors of our church, and she has a travel agency that, to even say it, sounds kind of too warm for this day, but it's called Beach Bum Travel, and she does a lot of trips to various places, but she is doing a Christmas drive to benefit the poorest sections in Cancun. And there is a list of items that she would be able to use. The deadline for that is December 5th. There are a couple of suitcases that are set up out there by the church office that you can put things in. The Thanksgiving dinner will be held this Thursday from 11:30 until 1, and desserts and help could be used. And this is really hard to just announce. So sorry. I am certain that all of us are very aware that our friend Jan Boyer went to be with the Lord this week. Jan made a contribution to so many organizations and activities in this whole community, and especially in our church family. Her love for the Lord translated into a cheerful sweetness, an optimism, and a willingness to help in any way she could. She lived her faith, and we're going to all miss her. Oh, I'm so sorry. Her memorial service will be Monday, November 28th at 2 o'clock with visitation at the church from 11 a.m. until 2 o'clock and then a luncheon following the service. I know we've been praying for the family, but if we could just continue. It's a difficult time, even though I know Jan is in heaven. Probably she's just taken over up there and doing everything she did down here. I know the Lord's got a list a mile long for her, but it's so hard. I mean, not just our church, but I went to the grocery store yesterday and so many people stopped to say something about how sorry they were and how much they're going to miss her. Another dear friend and member of this church, Al Pontius, many of us who've been here for a while remember Al so well, is a warm, kind, funny guy. He's not been a part of the congregation for the last year or two just because of his time of life and hard for him. But I recall a few years ago, following the death of Ethel, his wife, and we went to Christmas Carol at his house. And I remember that he stood with us, and he cried the whole time, but he sang those songs with us, and it was just a precious memory for me. But his memorial service will be Saturday, December the 3rd, and time and location are pending. One more. Harding Stevenson, one of our wonderful senior highs, also known as the son of Tom and of Carla, and the grandson of Don and Sandra, broke his humerus and fractured the arm during weightlifting this week. It will require repair with plates and screws, and the surgery will be tomorrow at Reed Hospital in Richmond. He's had an outstanding record in these first 2 years of weightlifting. I know there's concern. Tom has told me that they feel pretty confident that the surgery is going to take care of it, but I know there's still that worry. So please pray for him and the doctors and for a successful outcome for the surgery. There are other announcements in the bulletin. Please take time to read through them. And now, Jocelyn Sheldon will come and do a minute for missions for us.
Good morning. This morning, I want to tell you a little bit about Grace Bible Baptist Church, located in Denham Springs, Louisiana, fairly close to Baton Rouge. It's a nice, small church, well-kept, has a membership of probably about 25 to 30 people. It happens to be where my youngest son, Ted, known as Teddy to a lot of you, and his wife, Bonnie, and my grandchildren, Cody and Sadie, go to church. Well, back in August, you might remember hearing in the news, it started to rain down in Louisiana. It was recorded, I believe, on Friday that it rained some 9 inches, and the next day, 29 inches. And much of the area was flooded. And it took several days for the church members to get into their church, and at the same time, many of the church members were dealing with flooding in their own homes. Well, when they were finally able to get into the church, what they discovered was total destruction. The high water mark on the walls was 6 feet high. The church had been filled with water. Everything in the church was ruined. The pews, the windows, the doors, the pulpit, the piano, the sound system, the bathrooms, the Sunday school area, the hymnals, and the Bibles. The pastor lost all of his library, both in the church and in his home. Well, this little group of people got together because they knew they had to do something quickly because they didn't want the mold to set in. So they tore out the walls, the insulation. They tore out the ceiling. They basically tore down the church down to the bare bones of the church. Word spread, of course, around the country that help was needed in that area, and help was needed by this little church. And offers poured in. The publisher of their hymn books offered free replacements, and other churches offered theirs. They probably now have more hymn books than they can possibly use. They were offered pews and or chairs to replace the pews in the church. And just like Presbyterians, they had to have a meeting to decide which they wanted to use. I haven't heard the outcome of that yet. Anyway, some men came over from Texas, and they helped put up drywall, and they've been helping. There's one gentleman that comes every week since August and just does work around the church to try and get it back together. Well, because of all of the damage and the work that still needed to be done, They weren't able to worship in the church, but they followed the example of the early church, and they started meeting in homes. And they adopted a statement, or we might call it a mission statement, saying, "The water will not stop us from worshiping our Lord." I talked to Ted this past week. I talk to him every week, but in particular, I talked to him about their church. And he told me there is still work to be done. The flooring's not done, painting needs to be done, just a lot of things that need to be replaced. But a few weeks ago, they decided to return to the building, to the church, and now it's BYOC, bring your own chair. So they've been coming with lawn chairs and kitchen chairs, folding chairs, whatever they happen to have, so that they can worship in their church. And he told me that they truly feel blessed with the outpouring of love and generosity they have felt from all over the country. Now, I'm not telling you this because I want you to help them financially or in other ways, because they will be okay. They're a strong group of people. But I'm telling you, I think, more because I think sometimes if we can put a personal story, a personal example of how people go through something, it helps us to understand it more. But because they are just one of the stories in Louisiana that was affected, there are 1,000 more. There are still piles and piles of furnishings and what have you sitting out at the curb waiting to be picked up all over that area. They're not through yet. But there is a way for this church to help. The mission committee of First Presbyterian is sponsoring a Christmas bazaar. They're going to hold it the first 3 Sundays in December after church in the social hall. The proceeds will go to the EPC World Outreach Mission to help flood victims in Louisiana. So, all you bakers, all you crafters, knitters, quilters, whatever it is you have as talent in, we've talked about talents a lot, as you prepare for Christmas and prepare your cookies or banana bread or whatever, think about donating some of that to the bazaar. Package it up, bring it, put it out, put a price on it. And the other thing that can happen is every one of you, after church those 3 Sundays, needs to come back to the social hall and check out the bazaar, check out what's there, and be there to help this cause. Thank you.
Jocelyn, thank you for making that something we don't necessarily hear on the news. Thank you so much. And I do remember Teddy. He's still Teddy to me. And Marshall. In fact, I subbed at the junior high on Friday, and I had probably 5 kids in the 7th grade class that I had who were out of his era. I mean, their parents were. That had been part of our church. I'm thinking, oh my gosh. Let us pray. At this time, let us prepare ourselves for prayer. Father God, in this quiet moment, help us not just to listen to spoken words, but to listen for your still, quiet voice, to know that you are God, that you are worthy of our praise. Let us put aside those thoughts, concerns, wants that distract us. Let us confess those deeds and thoughts that we call mistakes and failures, but that you call sin, and that you gave your Son Jesus to die for those sins to allow us to live in relationship with you. Create in us a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within us. Restore to us the joy of your salvation and grant in us a willing and grateful heart. Gratefulness to you opens our hearts and minds to your comfort, your calmness, your call, your choices, courage to connect with this world and to be able both to confront and to comfort others. Our world needs people who know you personally and desire to be faithful to your guidance. We ask for that leadership and for your peace and your protection for all people. We pray for our church as it strives to serve one another and others in the community, for Pastor John and Nikki and Marna Lise and Angie and Danny and Don, for the vision team and deacons and session and Sunday school classes, and for the prayer ministry that Angie continues for us, for the Evangelical Presbyterian Church and the cross-cultural workers, Sam and Krista, for the Holcombs and the Castelluccios, and for the Philip Brewers. And Father, you know the concerns related to families in our church, our community, health, employment, family issues, financial needs. Please hear and meet those needs. We pray specifically for Jan's family, for Don and Beth and John, and Alex and Paul and Scott and his family. It's so hard to let go of Jan, even though we absolutely know she is with you. We also pray for Al's family, his son Richard and daughter Carol, and their families, again, for comfort and reassurance through this time. We hold up others we love in this family, Jack Horner, and Tony Walters, and Ben Hudson. Be very close to Harding and the family this week and make this surgery successful so that Harding can continue using the abilities and talents you have given him. And Father, we also want to pray for Craig and Susie Leland's Megan and her husband Ricky as they prepare for a new little one this week. Help with the birth and bless them all. Thank you, Father God, for listening to our needs. We know that you will give answers. And let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As Zach comes up to do the scripture, I have to tell you a little background, behind-the-scenes story. Our senior highs for several years have been doing scripture, and it's not always something they really can't wait to do. But they do it, and they seem willing. But this week, Alex had told me probably 2 weeks ago or something he was going to be able to do it, and then had a concert, and he wasn't going to be able to. And of course with Jan. And so when I found that out, I called Harding, and Harding was going to do it. And Harding said, of course I'll do it. Alex is my friend. And then when Harding couldn't do it, then I talked to, sorry, Zach, I didn't mean to go behind your back, but I talked to your mom. And she said she would ask Zach, and Zach said, of course I'll do it. Harding's my friend. I just want to tell you that. I just thought that was so neat. Thank you.
Here is the word of the Lord, Psalms 100. Make joyful noises to the Lord. All the earth worships the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter the gates with thanksgiving and his courts and praises. Give thanks to him, bless his name, for the Lord is good. Steadfast love and endurance forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
And I want to thank Kim for accompanying us today on the flute. Thank you so much. And just a reminder, too, that following this service of worship today, we will be having a congregational meeting for the purpose of electing officers. So we do hope that you stay for that brief meeting. At this time, I'd like to invite all of you to stand, if you will, and we will read responsively 1 Thessalonians 5, 12 to 18. It's on page 205 in the New Testament section of your Blue Pew Bible. I invite you to stand as we read this responsively. Let us hear the word of the Lord. But we appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to respect those who labor among you and have charge of you in the Lord and admonish you. And we urge you, beloved, to admonish the idlers, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with all of them. Rejoice always. And give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. Let's just bow our hearts in prayer together. Our loving and gracious God, we thank and praise you for your goodness and grace, and we thank you for this time of worship and the opportunity to look into your word. So open it up now for us, Lord, and be our teacher as we seek to know your truth. We ask these things through Christ our Lord. Amen. Thanksgiving is right around the corner, and all the good things that come with Thanksgiving, and I don't want to indulge you that way, but certainly the turkey, the dressing, the pumpkin pie, all of that, a wonderful experience. But, you know, Thanksgiving is really about the expression of our blessings and thanksgiving to God for all the things that he has bestowed upon us. You know, and certainly that list is many. I mean, when you think about family, you think about this church family. You think about a roof over our head, food to eat. You think about the freedoms that we enjoy. You know, the list goes on and on. And what are those two or three blessings that perhaps you are most thankful for? That's not rhetorical. I'm wanting some response. Just shout it out. What are you thankful for?
Family.
Family. Health. Church family, wisdom. Yeah, you know, there is so much to be thankful for. You know, during Luann's children's sermon, she talked about tape. And the only story that I could say, I'm not sure I was real thankful for tape, but it taught me a great lesson. When I was in Mr. Bonham's wood class in seventh grade, this guy just loved to talk. Now, is that any bit of a surprise to you? And he took out duct tape. Let me tell you, there's a new purpose for duct tape, right across the mouth. I learned my lesson. Yeah, there are many things for which to be thankful. And we can go on and on. But you know, Thanksgiving is good. It's good for the soul. You know, it's one of those things with this human body of ours, our human psyche, our soul, that, you know, we are at our best when we give thanks to God because it helps our personal well-being. And interestingly enough, research proves that point. It shows in so many ways that when people are thankful, they have improved immune systems. They feel that connection with others. And there's that sense of great sense of support and love and morale that comes when there is that kind of thanksgiving being expressed. And you probably felt it in your family, on a committee, certainly here in the church. You know, when there's Thanksgiving, it boosts our morale. But you know what also it does? It helps us sleep. Studies show in the journal Applied Psychology, Health and Well-Being, that if we were to take time 15 minutes before we go to bed, it says, and then write down what we're thankful for, it says that probably we will go to bed faster, sleep faster, and stay asleep longer. So I don't know if there's anyone here that deals with insomnia at night or can't wait to have that, brain shut down. Maybe that would help. You know, well-being is so important, and giving thanks promotes that. It helps heart health, they say. It helps relationships. People even are shown to do a greater performance on the job and at school when there's thanksgiving in their lives. You know, we know that when we look at a glass, it can either be half full or half empty. And how important it is to be around people who have that kind of positive thrust, who are thankful, who are filled with praise. It means a lot. Now, Walter Matthau in the movie Grumpy Old Men certainly did his character well, but who among us wants that character to describe our lives? The benefits of giving thanks and praise, being positive, there's so many. However, you know, there are times in giving thanks that it can be really challenging. You know, it's one thing to give thanks for the positive things in our life, but what about those difficult things? Open up your Bible and turn to page 205, again in the New Testament section. It says, give thanks. And giving thanks, as we said, is good for our well-being. It has many benefits. But at times it can be problematic in your life and mine. Paul says here, give thanks in all circumstances. In all circumstances. Does Paul really mean that? You're saying, Pastor, you mean I have to give thanks when I was let go of my job this year? Do I have to give thanks because of a loss of a loved one? Do I have to give thanks when that abscess tooth sends me to Dr. Leland's office? Do I have to give thanks for those things? And Paul would say to us, no, not at all. You see, he says, give thanks in all circumstances, not for all circumstances. It's hard to give God thanks for sorrow, for loss, for disappointment, for difficulty, for hardship. It's hard to thank God for those things. But in all circumstances, it's a totally different thing. Paul says in Romans 8:21, in all things, God works together for good to those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. In all things, God works together for good. You see, it's in the circumstance of what we go through that God has an opportunity to work his miracles in our lives, to transform our thinking, to point out those lessons that can help us in our maturity, that can grow us in our character. It's in all of those things that we can give thanks. Many of you know that I had melanoma a few years ago. And every 6 months, I go in and have my moles checked. I lose my modesty. And let me tell you, he checks me out stem to stern. Was I thankful for melanoma? No, not a bit. It was scary. It was frightening. I didn't know where it was leading before I had all the tests done. It was not a pretty picture. But in that circumstance, I could give thanks because God used it to open up all sorts of lessons that have helped mature me as a person, as a believer. First of all, how fragile life is. Because it is fragile. And how we can take it for granted each and every day. And yet, we don't know what's around the corner. And how we need to appreciate our families, our church family. How we need to appreciate the good things that God brings into our lives. I also learned how vulnerable I was. You know, I used to be more of an athlete than I am today. But, you know, I've generally been able to do physically what I've wanted to do. And that made me realize that I've got limitations. I am vulnerable. That was a good lesson to learn. It taught me the importance of prayer. And let me tell you, I developed a few scabs on my knees. It taught me the importance of dependence upon Jesus Christ and leaning upon him in faith. You know, I could have learned those things academically, but they wouldn't have really hit my heart unless I had gone in the circumstance of melanoma. And God is more interested in our character development than he is our comfort. You know, what are those things in your life and in mine that God's trying to teach us in the circumstance of life? You know, James says in chapter 1, beginning at verse 2, "My brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of any kind, consider it nothing but joy, because you know that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its full effect, so that you may be mature and complete, lacking in nothing." You see, we can't learn those lessons in a vacuum. We can read them on the page. It's theoretical. But they only really apply to our lives when the rubber meets the road. When we go through those moments, that's when we learn those lessons. You know, it says, "Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God." Now, we're to give thanks, certainly because it's the will of God that we experience that kind of well-being. We've talked about it, emotional, spiritual, psychological well-being. But we give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God. We are in Christ Jesus. You see, because we are in Christ as Christians, as opposed to those who are outside of Christ, who don't know Jesus, his mind is within us. His thinking, his perspective. You see, we can look at life differently because we have Christ within us. And so as where the world might say, you know, how can you even give thanks in the circumstance? We can say, yes, we can give thanks in the circumstance, because God works his miracle of turning that circumstance into something good in your life and in mine. Life is difficult. Brokenness, sin infiltrated this world. But the good news, my friends, is that our Lord gives us that ability as we partner with Him to see those dire circumstances turn into something meaningful, valuable, and helpful. This is the period of Thanksgiving. May it just not be a day or a week, but may it be a lifetime of Thanksgiving. And friends, let us not only give thanks for those positive things for which we know all too well, but those circumstances in which we are in right now. And maybe you're in that place where the verdict is out, where you can't readily see those lessons. But be patient. Be patient with yourself. Be patient with God. Because God will expose them and bring them about. We need to be that light on a hill that shines bright to a broken and needy world who is desperately in need of knowing that a good and loving God can take dire circumstances and do something for our benefit, and most importantly, for His glory. So what are we going to do? Give thanks. Amen.
As we dedicate our offerings that we may have put in the boxes as we came in or as we leave, let us use this time for contemplation of all that we have for which to be thankful. And let us pray. Father, you are good. Especially as we approach this Thanksgiving, help us to really see that all that we have is from you, and to give back from your blessings with a grateful heart. Amen. Let us stand and sing, "Crown Him with Many Crowns."
Eternity.
bright morning star. And throughout eternity, I'll sing your praises, and I'll reign with you throughout eternity. And I'll reign with you throughout eternity. Sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy. Sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy.
And now go into the world in peace. Hold on to what is good. Render no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing that his Spirit goes with you. And may the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance and give you his peace, both now and in the life to come and forever. Hallelujah.
Edition of God's Living Word, a program brought to you by First Presbyterian Church in downtown Greenville. If you're looking for a church home, we would love to invite you to come to our Sunday School Hour, which begins Sundays at 9:30, with morning worship to follow at 10:30. We're located in historic downtown Greenville at 114 East 4th Street. We can be reached at 937-548-3188. And if you're looking on the web, we're at www.greenvillepres.org. Throughout the week, we've got several ministries, small groups, Bible studies, along with youth and children's ministries on Wednesday afternoon and into the evening. There's something for everyone. And we do hope that you might consider First Presbyterian. We would love to have you part of our worshiping community, whether it be in person or on our telecast Wednesday evenings. But until next time, may God's word dwell richly in your life. Goodbye from First Presbyterian.